scripture reading comes from Mark 3, 7 through 19. Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd from Galilee followed. When they heard about all he was doing, many people came to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, and the regions across the Jordan and around Tyre and Sidon. Because of the crowd, he told his disciples to have a small boat ready for him, to keep the people from crowding him. For he had healed many, so that those with diseases were pushing forward to touch him. Whenever the impure spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." But he gave them strict orders not to tell others about him. Jesus went up on a mountainside and called to him those he wanted, and they came to him. He appointed 12 that they might be with him, and that he might send them out to preach and to have authority to drive out demons. These are the 12 he appointed: Simon, James, John, Andrew, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, Simon, and Judas, who betrayed him.
Well, good morning. We are moving right along in our series in the Gospel of Mark, and today we get to consider together one of the really great passages in the New Testament that speak to God's mission and the role of the church within it. And if you've had much history with other churches, and even if, you know, if you've been within the rock over the course of its history, you've seen that there are substantial differences between churches. There's substantial differences between churches, and then even within the rock itself over the past 10 years. As I've talked with you during the call process here, you've said like, oh yeah, this church is totally different than it was 10 years ago. And while some of those differences, they might appear to just be about musical tastes. You know, we might have the organ, or we might have guitar, or they might be about other surface level sort of things. The main differences that you have perceived in those churches, they actually haven't been about the surface issues. They've come down to a difference in understanding of God's mission in the world and the role that we're created to play within it. You know, the things that we emphasize as a congregation, or that other congregations emphasize, for better or for worse, they're always going to spring from our understanding of who God is and what he's called us to do. And, as people of the book, as people of the Bible, here at The Rock, we are trying to develop a solid understanding of what God's mission is and how we ought to come alongside of it. That's what we want here. We want to understand, why did God create us? Why did he redeem us? Why did he put us here on this earth until he comes back again? That's what we want. And so we're going to look at this passage and we're going to see a bit more of who God is, what he has called us to in this life, what his mission is, how we come alongside of it. And so without further ado, let's pray. And we'll consider it in this passage we just read. God, we thank you. We thank you that you have given us your word, and that in this word you show us that you are the one who can provide for us what we truly want, the deepest need that we have. You can provide that for us. And Lord, may we also see here that you want to provide that for us. You want us. Pray this in your name, Lord. Amen. So if you have your text open today, it begins with Jesus withdrawing after he had this incident with the Pharisees. He withdraws with his disciples to the sea. And there's a great crowd that's crowding around him, and they're pressing all around him. Because word had gotten around about all these amazing things that he was doing, all these miracles that he had performed, and they're trying to see if he's going to do something for them. Jesus is being pressed in by the crowd, even to the point that Jesus turns to his disciples and he's like, guys, get a boat. These people are going nuts. They're going to crush us if we don't have a little spot that we can get out to. And so they get a boat so that he can not be crushed by the crowd. It's like Jesus is a TV at Walmart on Black Friday, pre-COVID, all right? Back when we had madness in the world. People are just, they're going nuts to get a hold of him, just to touch him. They want him. They're pressing around him. They're harassing him. And eventually, he's just got to escape up a mountain, and that's kind of the second part of the text. Now, something that we really can't just brush over is the fact that these people were really needy. They actually were needy. They didn't just have these wants. Some of these, they had physical disabilities and infirmities, and they had no hope of ever getting better unless Jesus did something for them. They had no hope here. You know, it's not like they were just trying to get a earlier appointment with Jesus than they could get with their primary care provider. You know, like, for them, it's Jesus or bust. He is their hope to get better. But it's not just those with physical needs that are coming to him for aid. He's also got people that Mark says have unclean or impure spirits. And the sense is that they are being oppressed by demons. Whether it's a psychological thing or a physical sort of thing, they are being oppressed by demons. And the implication of this is that there really is such a thing as evil. There actually is something that we can call evil. The reason why someone experiences something wrong in this life is whether it's in their body, their mind, or just even in society. It's not just because of some sort of natural order that just always has to be the case. It isn't just that, oh yeah, I guess this is always going to be bad. But rather, the reason why is that something has gone terribly wrong. There's an attack on the good. The good of creation has had something go wrong with it. And throughout history and in the various religions of the world, this has generally been the understanding of the bad of life. That it's actually something bad and that we should do something about it. And now we may have, you know, different understandings in different religions, different contexts of exactly how that bad happens and what that bad really is. But we all pretty much agree that there is something wrong with life. There's something wrong with life. And those within more of like a spiritualistic religious worldview, they often think of life in terms of relationships between an unapproachable God and maybe more approachable gods or little deities or spirits or, you know, things of that sort that you can relate to. And then the rest of the created world is really kind of a threefold sort of picture there. And if everything is in balance, everything is good. It all works out. If you have a good relationship to yourself, to other people, and to the rest of creation, it's all going to be good. But the problem is that life is not in balance. Our relationship to ourselves is broken. We are self-destructive. Our relationship to others is broken. We manipulate and take advantage of others. Our relationship to the rest of creation, the created order in society, is broken. We pollute the earth, and we form societies that function on the basis of oppression. And the spiritualist kind of explanation of this is that the gods or spirits are upset, maybe with each other or maybe with us. And so they're causing all sorts of ruckus. And if you want to get things back under control, you're going to have to appeal to them, the gods, the spirits, the kami, to help fix the things of your life. So do you want your digestion or your dating life or your crops to work out and be fixed? Well, there's a sacrifice that you can make, or a fortune that you can buy from the local temple that'll hopefully get that done. And I actually got to see this when I was in Japan, when we visited a Shinto shrine. And that's my buddy doing the peace signs right over there. But, you know, you could go to the temple, and you could buy this little thing, and inside of it you had what basically amounted to a fortune cookie paper sort of thing. And it was, if it was good, that was awesome, but maybe it was bad, and you don't know what you're going to get. And so what do you do if you get a bad fortune? Well, then you can buy this orange gourd, and you can stuff the bad fortune into it, and then you can hang it on some racks, and then the bad fortune can't get to you. And it's a really, really good selling strategy that they have there. But you're going to be safe from the bad fortune if you kind of do these things to appease the spirits or whatever name you put on it. It's going to look different in different contexts, but basically there's a dead relative, a spirit, some god, a force out there that you need to influence in order to help make things right for you in the world. And that's kind of how someone with more of a spiritualistic worldview might explain what evil is and how to take care of it. The materialists, on the other hand, they also acknowledge that something has gone wrong with life, but they don't have a spiritual realm or a god to kind of blame things on. And so the problem is actually rooted in the observable universe. This is kind of how it works. There's a ton of variation within this view, but the main thing to note is that the materialistic worldview essentially points the finger either at ourselves, at you guys, or the rest of the created world, okay? That's where the problem is. And so you try to fix that problem and then life will be good. And so maybe the reason I am depressed is because there is something wrong with me. And so I'll seek out medication or therapy to fix me. Or maybe it's because the problem is with other people, in which case I will go to them, to my family and friends, to help change their behaviors. Or I'll just find other friends to be with, or a new job, or whatever. Or maybe the problem is with society itself. And so I'm going to try to change it to work better for me, or for other people that are like me. Now here's what I don't want you to hear, okay? Please don't hear me wrong on this. There's nothing wrong with fixes like that. Those are good things to do. The Christian is not anti-self-help or anti-change. Like, we don't just take things as they are and just like, I guess it's just bad. Like, no, like, we can make changes in this life, and those are good. But here's the problem with just that way of fixing evil. The answers that materialism provides are just surface level. It's all they are. You know, materialism, it doesn't give a good enough answer for the question of why bad exists in the first place. Other than that, it just does. It just does exist. You know, it might give some good ideas for how we might fix some issues, but it doesn't explain why bad exists. Or even beyond that, it doesn't adequately explain why we should fix it when it doesn't directly affect us. Really, the issue with materialism is that it doesn't have a sufficient answer for calling something evil, or for that matter, even good. It describes what is in terms of cause and effect, and it rejects the notion of something being absolutely evil or absolutely good. And because of that, it doesn't adequately explain why we should be selfless or why we should be self-sacrificial. And yet we know from experience that way of life is necessary for society to function and for any real change to take place. People need to be good even when it doesn't benefit them directly. In order for society to function rightly, it takes the strong to not just not eat the weak, but to actually lift them up above them. In order for society to work, that's what you need to do. We need to have that. And yet, the materialistic worldview doesn't do a good enough job of giving a basis for living in that way. It just addresses minor symptoms but not the cause of it. And now for the theist, or more specifically the Christian, good and evil are defined by God. And specifically good, being defined by God himself, means that creation either receives the good that God has to give us, and so live in line with him and what he has said, or we reject his good and live in opposition to him and thus experience evil. And insofar as we are receiving the goodness of God, life works out well for us. But insofar as we are rejecting the goodness of God, life does not work out well for us. And so the creation's relationship to themselves, to others, and to the rest of creation are, unfortunately though, are broken, as we have seen. And they don't work right. We don't live in such a way that everything is working out right. But here's the key here. The issues that we experience with the rest of our relationships to ourselves, to other people, and to the rest of creation, they start with a break in our relationship with God. They don't start with me. They don't start with the other person. They don't start with creation. They start with a broken relationship with God. If you drive down deep enough, the reason why I'm depressed or why I abuse myself is because I have not listened to what God has said about me. I haven't received his word about me. The reason why I mistreat other people is because I have not received and listened to what God has said about them, how he values them. The reason why I abuse the earth and ignore the needs of society is because I have not listened and received what God has said about them. It's true for me, and it's true for all. Since the Garden of Eden, we have rejected what God has given to us. And so now we are living as both victims of evil and victimizers of evil. We're victims and victimizers to ourselves, to other people, and to the rest of creation. We're in a tough spot. And really, if I can just draw out the distinction a little bit more, in the Christian understanding, the things that we experience as evil in life, they're just symptoms of the real issue that's going on. The real evil, which is a broken relationship with God. And it's sort of like what happens when you get sick with a cold or some other virus. You know, depending on the virus, you may experience a number of different symptoms. Maybe you get a headache, or you get a fever, or a stuffy nose, a stomach ache, diarrhea. I don't know. We could go further. We can get gross. You experience symptoms, whatever it is. It depends on the individual or the particular virus that you're getting. But the interesting thing is that a lot of the times, those observable symptoms are not just the effects of the virus, but they're also the effects of the immune system trying to fight off the virus, trying to stop the virus from overtaking the cells in your body. And so really, whether it's the virus or your immune system causing the symptoms that you're experiencing, they all function in basically the same way. They're signs that something is going wrong in your body and that you need a fix for that thing or else it's going to be really bad. You can treat the stomach ache, but the thing that is causing the stomach ache needs to be taken care of, or you're going to be in a real world of hurt soon. And in this way, our broken relationships to ourselves, to others, and to the rest of creation, they're just symptoms of the greater issue, the greater cause, the root cause of all of bad that needs to be addressed, and that is our relationship with God that's broken. The reason why we experience the evil in this world is because either our relationship with God is broken or other people's relationship with God is broken. That's why we experience evil. And the problem that Scripture tells us is that we can't mend that broken relationship. We can't go to the temple and buy a fortune to make him pleased with us. We can't do some good deed to make him say, oh yeah, I guess you're really great now. We can't manipulate him. Instead, we need God to mend the broken relationship. We need him to restore that relationship. And that's what he did through Jesus. He actually gave us the thing that we all really want deep down. If we go back to our text here, this is why Jesus leaves the clamoring crowd, goes up a mountain, and appoints the 12 to go out in his name. As we talked about, the greatest needs that the crowds had was not so much to just have their physical ailments or their mental ailments relieved, but rather to have the root cause of those symptoms addressed. And in order to do that, Jesus is going to have to eventually go to the cross and pay the price for their sin of rejecting God. That's the real thing they need. And that's what Jesus is going to do. But he can't just do that. He also is going to have to train some of his followers so that they can proclaim the meaning of what he was going to do for them, so that people could then receive that forgiveness of sins. He needs to preach and get to the cross, and he needs to train others to then preach afterwards. And so he calls 12 guys to himself to be with him so that he might send them out to preach the good news of the kingdom of God, that it has come near, and to have authority to cast out demons. And there's really three aspects of this call that I want you to see here, because it really relates to all of us today. The first is this calling of the 12 was that they were to be with Jesus. You know, a lot of us, we can get kind of caught up in the next two pieces of being a disciple. But it begins with this first part. It begins with being with Jesus. The truth of all discipleship, all learning from another, begins with leaving your familiarity and cleaving to your teacher, joining to your teacher. There's a cost to discipleship. It means leaving and going to another. And the Greek actually helps us here in being a bit more descriptive of what's going on here than our translations kind of render it. It says that these 12 men departed to him, and then he made 12, which it says appointed, but they departed to him, and he made 12, whom he also named apostles, in order that they might be with him and that he might send them out. And the general sense here is that by being with Jesus, they are then formed into the people who can then be sent out. Jesus is making them into who they would become. They are leaving what they were before, and they are being made into something else by being with Jesus. It's the presence of Jesus that changes them. That's how they become what they became. I mean, it's just kind of crazy to think about how much time these guys actually spent with Jesus, though. You think the better part of 3 years, 10 hours a day, maybe, who knows? What would that do to a person to be with Jesus for that amount of time? I had seminary for 3 years, and there was a good bit of work with it, but it wasn't all spent reading the Bible. A lot of it was looking at NFL.com and dreaming about the Bucks being better. And you know, it wasn't all just studying scripture or learning grammar and all this sort of stuff. It wasn't all that. What would 10 hours a day for the better part of 3 years do to a person? Probably shape them to become less of who they were and more like Jesus in that course of time. Imagine that the things that defined these men in the past kind of stopped defining them eventually, and they began to look more and more like Jesus. Now, I should mention, Mark is not going to present that change for us at all, as we already saw when we looked at the end of Mark. He's not going to tell us about how Jesus changed their lives at all, but if we look at the book of Acts and our church history, what we'll find is that Jesus, through spending time with these men, Jesus turned these men into people who would go on to change the world. The presence with Jesus fundamentally altered who they were. And in Acts 4, we have this event where Peter and John, this is after Jesus is resurrected and he ascends up into heaven and he sends out his apostles to preach the good news. Peter and John eventually get arrested by the same people who were upset with Jesus. And when they were called to answer for their crime of proclaiming Jesus, they preached the gospel to their accusers. And the writer of Acts says, "When they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and common men," or the word there is idiotai, which, yes, where we get the word idiots from, "they were astonished, and they recognized that they had been with Jesus." Being with Jesus changes you. That's Jesus' goal. He wanted to change them. He wanted to make them into people who could carry his message to the masses, which is the second part of the call. He called them to be with him and called them so that he could send them out to preach. And preach they did. Some did this by leaving their homeland, by going to people all across the world, bringing the good news to them. And some did this by staying in their homeland, by preaching to their families, their friends, their countrymen, anyone that they could. And still others did it by writing the letters that ended up making up our New Testament. This is how they preached the good news. These idiots, if we can call them that, who were transformed by Jesus, they carried his message as far as they could. And now, even though they are dead, the message that they shared is continuing to be proclaimed all across the world, even today, even in this little city that we call Seattle. Their message is continuing on. Jesus brought them to be with him so that he could send them out to preach, and that's what they did. But Jesus didn't just send them out to preach. He also sent them out with authority to cast out demons. And if we look through the rest of the New Testament, we end up seeing that these men actually went on to do many of the amazing miracles that Jesus did. But also, and most notably, they ended up casting demons out of people. And something that we should really make clear here is that the casting out of demons, it was never just about people being freed from demons, but rather it was a sign to them of what the kingdom of God brings with it. It brings release from evil. That's what it does. It brings release from the corrosive effects of sin. It relieves the symptoms that we all hate. It casts out evil in all its forms, and it restores things to how they were created to be. It's what the kingdom of God does. And so really, what we have here is Jesus sending out his disciples to talk the talk and to walk the walk of the kingdom of God. And so when they saw evil, they sought to bring the kingdom of God to bear on it. Why? Because Jesus wanted to show people that God wants to meet the deepest need that we all have. And the signs that he and his followers did showed that to them as a visual teaching to them. I know this was a lot of kind of background sort of stuff here. Let's get to it for us. What does this mean for us today? For these men to be called to be with Jesus, to go out to preach, and to cast out demons. After all, we're not the apostles. We haven't had the same experience as they had. And yet, the things that defined them and their call in our passage, they also apply to us, at least in a small way, a limited way, I should say. We are also called to be with Jesus, to be changed by him as he speaks to us through his word. That's what we're doing here today. So we hear his word preached, as we read scripture, as we sing scriptural songs, as we read our Bibles through the week, as we do our Bible studies, we are seeking to be with Jesus, to spend time with him so that he would change us. That's part of what we're doing. And we are also called to go out and proclaim the message that the kingdom of God has come near in Jesus. We are called to preach that message. You know, you don't need to come up with some amazing testimony about how God has changed your life. That's not what you're called to do. You're called to share the message that he has given you to share. The message that God has come to earth in Jesus, and that he has paid the full price of our sins so that those who believe in him can be reconciled to God. That's your message to share. He's given that to you if you're a believer. You know, we are, as a church, we are a people with a message. A message that we are called to not just hide, but a message that we are called to share. And we really ought to. There's so many people in our neighborhood and that we talk to with the coffee cart, people in your workplace, people in your families who do not know that Jesus died for them, that God is for them, that he wants to restore them. He wants to care for them. There's so many people who do not know that. We can share that with them. We can share that message with them. But as it was with the apostles, we also are not just called to preach. We are also called to, in a sense, cast out demons. The apostles were empowered to do mighty works that we aren't, okay? So if you haven't cast out a demon this week, it's okay, okay? They were empowered to do these mighty works to demonstrate what the kingdom of God was like. And we've actually seen this throughout Christian history as we've kind of broken new grounds in different areas where God just does these amazing miracles often through our missionaries and through people who engage in evangelism there to kind of authenticate the message to the people to show that the kingdom of God really is drawing near. For us today, living in Seattle, what does it look like for us to cast out demons? Well, it probably looks like that we are in opposition to evil wherever we find it. That we see injustice and we seek to see it turned into justice. That we see poverty and we seek it to be replaced with wealth. That we see war and we seek to see it replaced with peace. Injury and infirmity replaced with wholeness and health. For us, we are seeing the symptoms in the world and we're saying, we don't want that anymore. We don't want this for us. We don't want it for our neighbors. We don't want it for the rest of creation. Let us reform it and restore this world back to what it was supposed to be. And if we go back to our graphic, that talks about how the goodness from God has been rejected and now it's affected all of our relationships. This is a situation that we are in this world. Our relationships are broken to ourselves, with ourselves. My mind doesn't believe all the time what it should believe. And so I harm myself. Our relationships to each other are not as it should be. And so we do not accept people unconditionally. We do not love them and give ourselves for them. Our relationship to the rest of creation is broken. And so, what we see here as Christians is we say, if our relationship with God is broken, but Jesus has come here, and he has made a way for us, our relationship, to be restored, maybe that means that some of our relationships, at least in part, can be restored. God didn't reject us. We rejected him. And now because of that, there's an unassailable wall between us and God. But Jesus came and he has given us a way back to him. In Jesus, we have someone who has broken down the barrier between us and God. We can receive him through faith. And through him, we can then see, at least in part, the restoration of all of our other relationships in this world. This is the Christian worldview of what we do now in this life. And so, as a community of faith, we now proclaim the message to the world that we have a God who wants them. A God who sees the value in them. A God who wants to provide all things for them. We proclaim the message that restores their relationship between them and God. And we proclaim that message not only with our words, but also with the signs that we do as we work to cast out the symptoms of evil and restore things to how they ought to be. And this is where so many of us can get this whole Christian life thing wrong. We can often think that we as a church should either be doing one or the other thing, but not both. We should only be concerned with being active in the community and doing all sorts of good things to address the evils around us. Or we can think that we should only be concerned about making sure that our teaching is right on and that we're proclaiming the forgiveness of sins and that people can come to receive the good news of Jesus through our words. It's either one or the other. And it's a false dichotomy. As a late missionary, Leslie Newbegin, once wrote, "Words without deeds are empty, but deeds without words are dumb. It's stupid to set them against each other. It is, for example, stupid to say the one thing that matters is to go everywhere and preach the gospel, and all other activities such as schools and hospitals and programs for social action are at best merely auxiliary and at worst irrelevant. But why should people believe our preaching that the kingdom of God has come near in Jesus if they see no sign that anything is happening as a result? If they can see no evidence that disease and ignorance and cruelty and injustice are being challenged and overcome, why should they believe our words if there is nothing happening to authenticate them? And on the other hand, it is equally stupid to say, preaching is a waste of time. Forget it and get on with tackling the real human problems of poverty, injustice, and oppression. That is to confuse the sign with the thing it points to." I think this is incredibly relevant for us as a church. That this is what we engage in, that we are both people of word and deed. That we engage in work that communicates the message that we've been given to share. And so, Rock, hear me. Love looks like something. It looks like something. If we say that God loves our community, but if we don't show it, our message is empty. But if we show God's love through our actions without explaining why we are showing those actions, why we are doing those actions, our actions are not going to make sense. But for us, we know that love looks like something. And if you're a Christian, what it means is that you know that love looks like a man who didn't look at you as someone who he just had to put up with, but rather as someone that he would give his life for. If you're a Christian, you know that love looks like a man who invites you to be with him so that he might transform you. You know that love looks like a man who invests his life in you so that you can then invest your life in others. You know that love looks like a man who could have written you off for how you have rejected his love, but who instead comes down and shows you again and again and again why you can trust him, why you can believe in him, why you can know that he loves you. Love looks like Jesus. It looks like this man that we worship. And my prayer for those you who are Christians, whether you're here in person or online, my prayer is that you are continuing every day to receive the love that God has for you through Jesus, that you are being with Jesus and that when he calls you to preach and calls you to do the works that he's called you to do, that you do them because you trust him. That's my prayer for you. And my prayer for you is also that he would change you so much that when people see you, they would see the effects of this man who wants them as well. My prayer is that the world would see this God who wants them through the way that we live our lives. So let's pray. God, we ask that you would transform us. We can't transform ourselves. This isn't a matter of us just trying harder to be good Christians. We need you to do your work in us. We need you to sanctify us, to cleanse us from the evil of sin. And God, may we remember what you have done for us to cleanse us from sin on the cross. May we seek to live in line with that so that this world can see that you want them, that you care for them, that you desire them. In your name we pray, Lord.